to some articles that I looked up, and you could tell me whether this is accurate or not. It said that you were making up to $3 million a day.
I've had days that I made $3 million.
You had a $3 million day?
Yeah.
Okay.
A few of them.
A few of them. Explain how you have a $3 million day.
Well, your big customers come through, a couple of them, and they drop off $200,000, $300,000. There were three or four spots that I had in L.A. where guys just stood out on the street that would make $100,000 a day, each one.
Each one?
Yeah.
Now, this actually built up. I guess you had operations in 42 cities?
I don't know how many cities. I mean,
a lot of cities.
We had a lot of cities
all throughout the country.
Yeah.
So explain to me, and okay,
you know, different people do their estimates and their calculations and all
right.
that stuff. So,
and I guess the other thing is that you moved $900 million worth of cocaine.
Or more,
which in today's dollars is the equivalent of $2.5 billion. So you were moving.
You figure like this here. If you do 100 kilos in one day, that cocaine goes a lot of places. You know, a lot of people, they taking it, they putting it on airplanes, they moving it around. Now you're talking about you move 200 kilos in one day, or 250. You're talking about that's a lot of cocaine.
Of course, we are continuing to conduct our own independent inquiry into this matter as part of our proper oversight responsibilities. We are keenly aware that this entire episode has fueled suspicions some people have about the advent of the scourge of crack cocaine in the United States. Any suggestion of government complicity in that terrible outcome is one that must be seriously considered and answered. It is our obligation as the committee charged with the responsibility of overseeing the CIA to address these concerns, to examine the facts as exhaustively as possible. It will be extremely difficult to come up with an absolute answer that will remove all doubt. Such is the nature of these cases. That said, I believe the American people have a right to expect us to do a conscientious job in understanding the facts and in offering conclusions from this committee about the charges that have been made.
Weapons to Iran, profits of which to be diverted to the Contras circumventing Congress on that issue. So when this issue became public, there was already a foundation of distrust. And while we all know, many of us know more about the valuable contribution the Central Intelligence Agency has made, we also know of some shortcomings in the trust department between the American people and the agency. So you have a climate where people are saying, what's happening to our community? Crack, the cheapness of it, the availability of it, is undermining our community. Who's doing this to us? Secondly, why isn't somebody, how can we stop it? Therefore, when this story hit, there was a climate that made it a credible story.
Defies the evidence and the logic that the CIA should have known. From the days of the CIA's first response to the allegations raised in the Dark Alliance series, many skeptics believe that the CIA could never produce a credible or truthful review of wrongdoings by its own agency. These skeptics could point, if they'd like, to this Sunday's Los Angeles Times to confirm their fears. The Times reported, in another case, that after 37 years, the CIA finally admitted publicly the most profound deception imaginable on an American family. Thomas Pete Ray and his top secret squadron of National Guard bombers were shot down during a CIA bombing mission in the Bay of Pigs debacle. For 37 years, the CIA denied that Mr. Ray and his squadron even existed, much less were shot down by Cuban troops in 1961. Only this month, faced with a document obtained by a Freedom of Information Act request by the National Security Archives, did the CIA finally admit the truth 37 years later. My deep concern about the allegations raised in the Dark Alliance series that my government could have in any way been involved in or had knowledge of drug trafficking has caused me to spend much of my own time and resources to find out more about these allegations. After reading the Dark Alliance series, I interviewed Gary Webb, the writer of the series. And by the way, Mr. Chairman and members, Mr. Gary Webb is here today. He's sitting right here in this seat, and I invited him to come. He's put a lot of time and work into this investigation, and I have been working with him since the first day that I read it, and I think that he should be privy to all information as he continues his work in this area.
My name is Gary Webb. I am an investigative journalist. I've been an investigative journalist for about 25 years for daily newspapers. And in 1996, I wrote a series of stories entitled Dark Alliance, which was about CIA involvement. Investigative journalist for about 25 years for daily newspapers. And in 1996, I wrote a series of stories entitled Dark Alliance, which was about CIA involvement in drug trafficking. What my story showed was that the cocaine that was being sold in those neighborhoods was coming from mainly one source, and this one source was being used to finance a guerrilla war in Central America. The general idea of the CIA dealing drugs was something that the American mainstream press had never written about before, and that's why it prompted outrage among blacks, among drug reform activists, among politicians, by the CIA, by every federal agency involved in the drug war, because it showed they weren't doing their jobs, that it was a fraud. Right after we published the stories, the support we got from the media was very favorable. Newsweek magazine did a big piece on the story and said it was well documented and well researched. The website was getting like a million hits a day. There were marches in Watts, there were marches in Compton, there were candlelight vigils. Every California senator demanded an official investigation. So the story itself was really building momentum. The government reaction was no reaction. And this, I believe, was a very careful strategy, because nobody was going to believe the government if they came out and said we didn't do it. The proof was fairly overwhelming, since we had all these government documents showing that it had happened. So what happened was they let the so-called liberal press speak for them. And they had the national security reporters at the Washington Post, who coincidentally used to work for the CIA, write stories saying it doesn't mean anything. It was a distraction from what the story said, and it became sort of a media war between the Mercury News, which stood behind the story at that point, and the rest of the establishment media, who wanted us to back away from it. And part of that reason was because these major newspapers had written about this issue back in the 1980s, but had written about it very dismissively, as if this is nonsense, it doesn't happen, it never happened. And then 10 years later, we came back with documentation showing that it was absolutely true and that it was worse than we thought. We had gotten a story out around them, and we had gotten it out in a big way that they couldn't control, and that was through the internet. And I think a lot of this was directed to the Mercury News to say, we don't care what documentation you have, we don't care what kind of story you've got, we set the national news agenda. And if we don't like your story, we will kill your story, regardless of its truth. The media rejoiced when this came out, because it meant they had won. They had forced a newspaper to back away from a story that was true, simply because of this barrage of criticism, of mindless criticism, essentially, that really took its toll on the editors of the newspaper. And they were being seen as sort of outcasts from the club. And I think they made a political decision that it was better in the long run take a dive on this story and get back in the good graces of the rest of the media. It was essentially a war between my editors and myself because I wouldn't apologize for the story or back away from the story, and fought them on it publicly. And so they transferred me to a bureau that was 140 miles from where I lived, and I called in sick a lot. One of the things I'm proudest of in regards to that story is the website that the Mercury News set up, because it really was the first time that a newspaper brought its readers not only into the interior of the paper, but into the reporters' notebooks. You know, this was a story that, as I told my editors, had a very high unbelievability factor built into it. A lot of people were going to say, this can't be true. And this story became a sensation because of the website, not because of the story, but because people could get to it. And they could never have gotten to it before because the San Jose Mercury News is a small regional newspaper in Northern California that you couldn't read if you lived in New York, or you couldn't read if you lived in LA. But this story you could read anywhere in the world and see all of our documentation. So it became, and we did this on purpose to make it very hard to knock down, to make it very difficult for people to say this didn't happen. But they said it didn't happen anyway.
Banging on Esau, HOI